The drug works to prevent pregnancy if it's taken within 3 days of having sex. It works best taken within 24 hours. When the current version was approved, anyone under 18 needed a prescription. But this spring, a federal judge rejected the age restriction on Plan B. As recently as late April, the Obama administration still wanted to require a prescription for anyone 14 or younger. But this week, they gave that up as well and said they would accept the ruling. So starting soon, Plan B will be available over the counter for everyone.
If you see this news with your kids, it's going to make a lot of people nervous, but I think that might be good. You know, we've got two leading sex and relationship experts with us today to talk about this. Joining from New York, Ian Kerner and Logan Levkoff. Thanks to both of you for joining us. And happy Father's Day weekend as well.
Happy Father's Day.
I wanted to ask some of these questions in that context to some extent, thinking about this as a dad of young girls. I know we all have kids. As far as I can tell, there are really no medical issues specifically here. I mean, the drug is considered safe. But Plan B seems to be more controversial because of the context of talking kids and sex. And again, all three of us are parents of young children. But a recent report found that fewer than a third of parents are talking to their kids about safe sex. Logan, let me start with you. How young is too young? What are we talking about here?
Well, there's never too young when it comes to talking about sex and sexuality. From the time we're born, we're shaping how our kids see the world, how they see themselves and gender and different types of families. It is our responsibility to talk to our kids about sex and safety and protection and consent and responsibility. And we have a huge opportunity to do so, whether we use the recent media news as a stepping off point or whether we just start a conversation at home. But it is our job to do it.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I think you're right. And you have a four-year-old girl. Look, I have a four-year-old girl. I also have a six-year-old girl, an eight-year-old girl. And I think this is consuming me. I mean, I'm thinking about this all the time. And Ian, I mean, kids are reaching puberty much younger as well. I think on average, 8 or 9 or 10 for boys, even younger for girls. Are they mentally and emotionally ready to have this conversation that Logan's talking about?
Well, it's funny, Sanjay. I mean, I have a son. He's in fourth grade. He's just turning 10 years old. He's nowhere near hitting puberty, but you know what? Other kids in the fourth grade, other kids in the fifth grade, they are hitting puberty. So whether he is ready or not, these conversations are in the air. These conversations are being talked about. So as a parent, my job, I feel like, is to be responsive. And, you know, for example, as Logan was just saying, recently in the news, for example, everybody was talking about Michael Douglas and the fact that right. HPV can be transmitted orally. Well, you know, my phone, my email, I have been receiving scores, dozens of emails from moms, dads, parents, sons, kids, men, women saying, is this true? What do I need to do? Tell me more about it. So I think that's an example of a teachable moment where nobody was necessarily prepared to have that conversation, but we have to be responsive parents.
Yeah, no, it's true. And Logan, let me ask you this last question. As a father of three girls on Father's Day weekend, I want my girls to like themselves. I want them to respect themselves. I mean, and maybe the answer is obvious here, but how do we give girls the self-confidence and self-esteem to create and protect their own boundaries?
We have to tell them that it's important to speak up for themselves, to know that they are not, their worth is not measured by what they look like, but what they're, who they are and their character and their contribution to the world. And it means that we challenge the little messages as they come up. My four-year-old is obsessed with princesses, and it's very hard to get away from that. But the one thing I say to her is that, you know, princesses go to work. Princesses have to have careers. And the most beautiful princesses are the ones who use their brains. And it sounds silly and a little bit like brainwashing on my part, but it seems to do the trick. And it is our role to step in and say, you know, you might see beauty in one way, but there's a lot of versions of beauty. And it mostly comes from inside, not outside.
I love that. I'm spending some individual time with my kids. We all have more than one child, and finding the individual time, I think, is so important, and maybe having some of these conversations. Thanks so much. I love watching you both. Thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.